Good morning, all. A warm welcome to our worship this morning. Welcome, particularly on this Remembrance Sunday, to our worship here. I have some notices that are largely on the sheet. Principally, can I invite you to tea and coffee following the service? All are welcome to share in that. Other things, essentially, I can leave you to take as read, though the material for the Christmas newsletter should be handed into the office or emailed by next Sunday, which means that you see my leave details on the sheet there, which I'll highlight, but that means that that's a reminder to the minister, so I'm going home after I've dealt with a service in Milton Bogoni this afternoon as well for Remembrance to write a Christmas newsletter, right? So that's fine. But all the notices are there. I am on leave from tomorrow until Tuesday 21st. Should you require the specific services of a minister during this time, please contact the Reverend Elizabeth Cranfield, whose phone number is there. And Iona, who's not here today because she was keeping the service going for me across in St. Kenneth, is also available. And her contact details, along with mine, are now on the back of the order of service permanently for you. To refer to, so please feel free to be in contact with us at any time, though just don't contact me in this coming week. We are met this day to glorify God, whose power sustains the world, to remember with thanksgiving those who lived and died in the service of this nation and of all nations, and to ask for God's help and blessing that we may be worthy of their sacrifice each day of our life. Let us worship God, remembering that God was and is our hope, and our shelter in every storm. We sing the first three verses of the hymn, O God, Our Help, in Ages Past, the hymn at 161, and as we sing this hymn, the colors will be received. 161. Let us remember the kindness of God and his favor to us in our time of need. Let us remember the courage, devotion to duty, and the self-sacrifice of the men and women in our armed forces, the toil, endurance, and suffering of those who were not in uniform, the support of those who sent help from afar, and who stood by those on the front line, and those who waited at home. Let us remember those who were wounded in the fight, those who perished in air raids at home, those who fell in battle, and those who are buried at sea or in some corner of a foreign field, and especially those whom we have known and loved, whose place is forever in our hearts. Let us remember those who were our enemies, whose homes and hearts are as bereft as ours, whose dead lie also in a living tomb of everlasting remembrance. Let us remember the continuing grace of God, whose love holds all souls in life, and to whom none is dead, but all are alive forevermore. They shall grow not old, as we that are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn. At the going down of the sun, and in the morning, we will remember them We will remember them. If you're able, would you please stand? In memory of those who died, may we be better men and women, and in gratitude to God, may we live as those who are not our own, but who are bought with a price. Amen. If you're able, would you please remain standing for the final three verses of the hymn 161, 1,000 ages in thy sight are like an evening gone, 161. Prophet Isaiah writes, those who look to the Lord will win new strength. They will soar as an eagle's wings. They will run and not feel faint, march on and not grow weary. Let us pray. On this day, especially, Almighty God, we come to remember. Of course, we come to remember those who gave of their lives for our freedom. But in these moments of prayer, we come also to remember again who you are and how you revealed yourself to the world. We remember your care in creation. We remember your creativity seen in the working of the human mind. We remember your desire that all things might work together for the good of those who love you. We remember indeed that your power sustains the world. Even if this is a hard day for us, gracious Lord, may what we remember of you today inspire us to worship you. Lord Jesus Christ, we come not just to remember, but to own for ourselves the reality that you offered yourself completely for us. In acts of kindness and generosity, in your death upon the cross of Calvary, in your rising again that death might finally be defeated. Where we have failed to live lives worthy not just of the sacrifice of fellow men and women, but of Christ himself, we seek your forgiveness in the silence. Sisters and brothers, you are forgiven, so be at peace. And now we unite in faith and prayer in the power of the Spirit and in the name and by the grace of Jesus Christ our Lord, who taught us in the family prayer of the Church in every age and place to say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Continuing our readings in Philippians, our scriptures are brought to us now by Margaret. Thank you.
The reading this morning is taken from Philippians chapter 4, verses 1 to 9. Therefore, my brothers and sisters, whom I love and long for, my joy and crown, stand firm in the Lord in this way, my beloved. I urge Euodia, and I urge Syntyche, to be of the same mind in the Lord. Yes, and I ask you also, my loyal companion, help these women, for they have struggled beside me in the work of the gospel, together with Clement and the rest of my co-workers, whose names are in the book of life. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again I will say, rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. Do not worry about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, beloved, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, and if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. Keep on doing the things that you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, and the God of peace will be with you. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
With the theme of peace emerging from our reading, and the peace of Jerusalem and the surrounding areas very much on our minds at the moment, we sing the metrical psalm 122 at the hymn 82. Pray that Jerusalem may have peace. The hymn 82.
Thank you.
Let us pray. In the peace of this place, may there be peace in our hearts as we receive peace from the Word and from your Spirit. Amen. I'm taking as a text for today the following verse from our reading, which continues our series in Paul's letter to the Philippians. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. A former president of the Norwegian Academy of Sciences and historians from England, Egypt, Germany, and India have come up with some startling information. Since the year 3600 BC, the world has known only 292 years of peace. During this period, there have been 14,351 wars, large and small, in which 3.64 billion people have been killed. The value of the property destroyed would pay for a golden belt around the world some 97.2 miles wide and 33 feet thick. Since 650 BC, there have also been 1,656 arms races, only 16 of which have not ended in war. The remainder ended in the economic collapse of the countries involved. These are sobering figures to contemplate as we gather today to remember those who paid the ultimate sacrifice. For the people in Philippi, the absence of peace started with two women. Their names are Euodia and Syntyche. Lots of biblical names are popular to this day, but strangely enough, Euodia and Syntyche are not among them. We are not told what their disagreement was about, but Paul longed that they would be of the same mind in the Lord. Surely at the root, many of the conflicts which have raged over the years have that very issue at their heart. People have not been of the same mind. Some disagreement emerges between people, and before long the conflict is not just between people, but between nations. It is against the backdrop of this disagreement between Euodia and Syntyche that Paul pens this beautiful verse about peace, a verse that has been beloved of believers ever since it was written. So what does Paul teach about the peace of God? Firstly, Paul teaches that the peace of God is a matter of the heart. Appropriately enough, for a day when we remember those who served and still serve in our armed forces, Paul employs slightly militaristic language here when he says that the peace of God will guard our hearts. Perhaps we might picture a sentry on duty, but this sentry keeps guard over the human heart and mind. If then we desire peace in our world, there must first be peace within each human heart. And the only way in which true peace is known in the human heart is when we enjoy relationship with God. Jesus puts it this way in verses which I've shared often over the years, though for the first time here. Come to me, says Jesus, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. The invitation is clear. Come to Jesus with all that wearies us and burdens us, and he will give us rest. And not just the kind of rest we experience from getting a good night's sleep, though that is vital for our physical and mental health, but a deep, lasting rest for our souls. Jesus offers us each that rest, that peace, and challenges us to share it with others. For when we share the peace that Jesus brings to us, to our hearts, with another person, and they share it with another person, and so on, we pay the most fitting tribute possible to those who gave their lives and whom we remember today. The peace of God is a matter of the heart. Secondly, the peace of God is not only a matter of the heart, but a matter of the mind. As with the heart, if we desire peace in our world, there must first be peace within each human mind. How is peace of mind achieved? In fact, Paul reflects on this in the closing verses of our passage. In conclusion, my friends, fill your minds with those things that are good and deserve praise. Things that are true, noble, right, pure, lovely, and honorable. Put into practice what you learned and received from me, both from my words and from my actions, and the God who gives us peace will be with you. In a sense, it's really quite simple. If our minds are full of those things which Paul identifies here, things that are true, noble, pure, lovely, and honorable, then our minds have no room for those things which cause conflict and war, dividing person from person and nation from nation. Of course, all of us know how life can cause our minds to be filled with that which does not serve us well, that which robs us of our peace, of the peace that God wants to give us. We also sadly know of people whose peace of mind is robbed by illness. Some of us may ourselves be affected by that, and it's right that they and we are treated well and given the care that they and we need. This story, with a lighter context, tells of how a lack of peace of mind in everyday life can affect us. A lady called Lucinda Norman writes of her experience Christmas shopping at the local shopping centre. People had been pushing, elbowing, and cutting in front of her all day. During a 10-minute extra 10% off special, one woman grabbed a lace tablecloth from her hands, looked her in the eye, and said, "Mine." She yanked it back and won the fight for the lace cloth. By 4 p.m., Lucinda's mood was belligerent. She met some friends in a restaurant and flagged down a waitress. She barked, "I need a hot tea now." The waitress snapped back, "I'm not your waitress. Wait your turn." Lucinda responded, "Lady, I've been waiting my turn all day. Bring me some tea." But the waitress ignored her, and a few moments later, a friendly young man came to their tables and said, "I'm Rob, your waiter." After he took their order, Lucinda watched Rob as he helped the rude waitress with her tray. He greeted the other customers and staff with a smile on his face. In the midst of all the hurried customers and chaos of the season, he had a polite and unhurried atmosphere of calm. When he refilled her tea, Lucinda noticed a silver ring on his hand made of connected letters which spelt Jesus. And then she writes, "From that moment, my attitude changed. This young man's example had reminded me of the peace which Christ came to bring." And for the rest of the day, Lucinda enjoyed her shopping, opening the door for others and letting others in front of her at the checkout, all in an atmosphere of peace. A trivial example, perhaps, but the point holds true. When Lucinda filled her mind with peace, peace was created all around her. When we realize that Christ alone is the source of our peace, our hearts and minds will be guarded against anything that threatens that peace, and we will share it with a hurting and love-starved world. Our tribute of thanks to all who fought for peace and who still fight for peace today. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We've reflected upon how we ourselves might share peace with the world, and we sing of that desire now in the hymn at 528, after which I invite you to remain standing for the dedication of the offering and sing "All That I Am." But for now the hymn, 528, "Make Me a Channel of Your Peace." Please be seated. And our prayers are brought to us now by Jean. Thank you.
Let us pray. Let us pray, God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, to bless the church and to strengthen her with the gifts of the Spirit, that she will not lose her nerve in godless times, nor underestimate the privilege of her worship, nor shirk the task of pursuing righteousness and reconciliation of all men to God, and in time another, Lord, to thy mercy. Hear our prayer. Let us pray, God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, to bless the nations with peace and to lead them away from violence and war to policies and provisions which reflect his love. Lord, in thy mercy, hear our prayer. Let us pray, God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, to show his favor to the king and to his house, to give understanding to his ministers, and to make clear to our people the way of wholesomeness and truth. Lord, in thy mercy, hear our prayer. Let us pray, God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, to stretch forth his right hand in help and blessing upon the victims of war and upon the bereaved, upon those who face mental suffering because of what they have seen or endured, and upon the distressed of this world and of our own number. Lord, in thy mercy, hear our prayer. Amen.
In our closing hymn, we take up Paul's encouragement to the Philippians to rejoice in the Lord, as we sing the hymn at 449, Rejoice, the Lord is King. The colours will be returned during this hymn. 449.
Thank you.
God grant to the living grace, to the departed rest, to the church, the king, the commonwealth, and all people peace and concord, and to us and all his servants life everlasting, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, now descend upon you and remain with you, and with those whom you love, those here now, those further afield, and those now at rest and gathered with their Maker now and even forevermore. God save the King.